Yeah.
The blessing.
I'm going to edit that out. I don't know what you're going to use in this, but...
No, I'm not editing any of that.
Years ago.
My dad's big into it. I'm not a...
You heard yourself just drink right there, right?
I guess you can't drink on these drink water.
You can. You just got to pull your. You got to, because you know you got to get out.
You got to just got to get out. You can still hear my mouth go.
Yeah. Conspiracy theories.
Okay, I'm satisfied with the sound that we could at least start at this point if you
okay.
wanted to.
Okay. So what are we calling this? It's your turn this time.
Welcome to Living Lord Live, the inaugural episode part dose. We should just call everything the inaugural episode part, you know, the inaugural episode part 110.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, I don't know. It's,
I don't know either.
I'm not the creative. I'm not creative.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Neither am I.
What we talk about is mostly Lutheran stuff. I'm mostly Lutheran.
Oh, is that... Okay, I see where we're going with that.
Do you want to call it something like, hey, welcome to the Mostly Lutheran podcast? I'm Lewis, and that there is a senior pastor, Stephen Cawley.
No. I mean, but I can see why you would want to call it Mostly Lutheran, because what is a Lutheran? I don't know either.
This doesn't look good for us. This is not a good way to start. We don't know what it means to be Lutheran.
I mean, I think there's a lot of people who are Lutheran and they just don't know it.
Oh, I think most of what people are in this life, in this world, are Lutherans.
That's, yeah.
It's just our job to help them realize that they're
right.
Lutherans.
Right.
Yeah.
And part of our job is to like gather up all the Lutherans and
share the good news. I go back to this thing. I think we have the best theology. Our theology is well positioned to meet 21st century and beyond, especially in a time of coronavirus. But we just don't have the very best, I don't know, salesmen to go out and spread that.
Yeah. Do you like Jimmy John's or do you like Subway?
What am I getting at Jimmy John's? Jersey Mike's, right?
Okay. Why do you like Jersey Mike's versus Subway?
Because they put more in it and their Mike's weighs a lot better.
But which one has more volume?
I would say Jersey Mike's. Bang for your buck, you're going to get a better deal probably either at Subway or Jersey Mike's. But Jersey Mike's has a certain flair to it. See what I mean? Know what I mean? Know what I'm saying?
Describe that flair. What do you mean by that?
It's a more vinegary... A more savory taste that comes through. Mm. Jimmy John's kind of blank and sometimes err on the side of sweet. Jersey Mike's, they're oil and vinegar. They've got a hot spread. I think they do it well.
Okay.
It's a little more savory.
Savory.
I prefer my sandwiches to be savory rather than sweet.
There was a cook at Texas Lutheran where I went. And steak night. We always had steak night every once in a while. And he always used this phrase that I always try and think about when I cook a steak. He put a little romance in it. He would always rub his fingers like that. You got to put a little romance in it.
You got to love it a little.
You got to love it a little. And it sounds like that's what your description of Jersey Mike's is. They're putting a little romance into their sandwich. Or let me rephrase it this way, because I know you like business. Their product is better quality.
Their product quality, I don't know, is any different than Jimmy John's or Subway's, but I like their romance more. I like the way they love their sandwiches more. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's my kind of romance. That's what I'm into.
They roll their dough in a special way.
I'm pretty sure it's store-bought. It might actually be Costco.
Yeah. Well, my point is that Is there, would you say there's a different quality of theologies? We're talking about a product, like, you know.
Sure, our theology.
Church has our, you know.
Yeah.
We're a package, but inside the package, then there's the message.
See, this is, so this gets tough, right? Is our theology our main product?
No.
Yeah. Are we selling our theology? This sounds so bad. Like, are we out there sharing our theology, or are we out there to say, come hang out with us? I think in a church sense, so this is, our theology shapes how we do church. Or does how we do church shape our theology?
Or is it not either or, both and?
Well, I mean, if you want to get into paradoxical thinking in that sense,
it's all paradox.
It's both.
Yeah.
It's both. Both and.
Yeah.
I struggle with this all the time. Like, is what's keeping people coming back good Lutheran, sound Lutheran theology?
Probably not.
Would I do this if I wasn't Lutheran, though?
Do what? This podcast?
I'd be working, be called, do church leadership.
I don't know.
I don't know that I would be a church leader if I wasn't Lutheran.
That's deep.
Is it? It's confusing. I'm just concerned about not delivering. Our first one was funny, and this one, we got onto the topic of being Lutheran.
Yeah, that jumped.
I don't know that that's a bad thing. I think that's a good thing. We should probably be talking about what it means to be Lutheran, but how important is it for us to be Lutheran? I see this with churches all across the ELC, across denominations, where they're dropping their denomination affiliation, where they're dropping their theological affiliation, right? It's like us going from Living Lord Lutheran Church to just Living Lord Church.
Or even drop the church.
Right, Living Lord. Right? Is that, do we sacrifice something by dropping Lutheran, by dropping church? Or do we knowingly make that sacrifice because we're going to gain more from it? So, I mean, that for me has always been a question going into churches and different congregations that that I've served. How important is it to be Lutheran?
Mm-hmm.
If it's just that we have a Lutheran hymnal and we teach confirmation using the small catechism.
We do have some good hymns, though.
Well, I mean,
it's a totally
not
subjective, I know, but
I'm not a fan of the cranberry. I don't know who's watching this, but if you worked on or were a part of the cranberry hymnal process, I think it's a marvelous tool. It's just not my romance.
So what is your romance?
Oh, a deep sense of liturgy, green hymnal all the way. Lutheran Book of Worship was the best thing to ever come about.
Why?
Because there are three settings, not 1,000. Yeah, the language might not be inclusive, but for me, and again, going back to my flavor of how church is done and what happens, that's the kind of romance I'm looking for. If I were to default between a contemporary worship service and a traditional mm-hmm. worship service, stylistically,
yeah,
I will always err on the side of high church.
Really?
Yeah, I'm a high church kind of guy.
I wouldn't have pegged you for a high church person.
What do I look like?
Well, with that suit on.
High church.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't think that it has to be one way or the other.
No, I mean, this goes
I mean, I like it both.
I both see that.
From my side of the table, sometimes it's kind of fun to get out of the pulpit, walk around, preach, interact, do things differently. Not wear the alb, the stole. But then there's a time where it's like, yeah, this makes a whole lot of sense. Like, why we do liturgy the way we do it. And
sure.
And my dad went to church. I don't know what your dad was like, but my dad hated church. Really did. I remember as a kid, he was sitting there and we'd all be doing the in the pew, and dad would look over, and dad was always like serious, always trying to be like the father. And he looks over at me, he's like, "This is boring." Like he kind of acted out was like he was a kid. And that's always stuck with me. Dad, like, he was a person of faith, but he just didn't see the value of worshiping. And in the end of his life, I never liked Joel Osteen.
Yeah.
Do you like Joel Osteen?
He's a hit and miss with me. I think he says, he's a hit and miss.
Okay. So dad, at the end of his life, when he was sick, here's the thing. I never liked Joel, but at the end of my dad's life, Joel Osteen fed his soul.
Hmm.
And how can I complain about what Joel's doing if that is feeding, particularly my dad's soul, who never liked worship?
Yeah.
And here he is at the end of his life watching televangelist.
Sure.
And got something out of it.
Yeah.
I mean, who knows what people are watching and thinking.
Sure.
Of this. I mean.
Yeah.
We got some decent comments on it. It's. I don't know if it's because it's funny or...
Both. We weren't very serious in the last episode. So going back to high church, right? I think back to the hymn. We sang it on All Saints Sunday. For all the saints. From whom their labors rest.
Okay.
I think the best version I've ever heard that done was... The recessional hymn for George H.W. Bush's funeral.
It was a good funeral.
And I thought it was very well done, and I liked, but again, yeah. A very high church.
Well, they were in Houston at an Episcopal church.
At the Episcopal, or yeah, was it in Houston, or was it out at the National?
He was Episcopalian. And if my memory serves right, the service they conducted was in Houston. I forget the name of the parish.
It looked like a beautiful church, gorgeous cathedral. It was probably the cathedral.
It was, because I remember the bishop who I met when I served down in Houston. He was kind of the John the Baptist kind of guy. Wouldn't expect he would be an Episcopal bishop.
Yeah.
You know, he had the hair flaming up, just these really cool, expensive cowboy boots, really nice.
Sure.
And when he talked, you listened. Yeah. One of those kind of guys. He was in George. He presided over the presidents. Andy Taylor. No, that's the bishop down. That's your bishop.
That's Pacifica Synod.
This bishop's name was Andy, I think. I don't know. I'd have to look it up. But anyway, yeah. So he was Episcopalian.
But that, to me, that style of service, right? That high church.
That's very organ, high. Yeah.
Very high church. That, for me, is what feeds my
your soul.
That's the romance that I look at, right?
Okay.
So if I'm church shopping, the church that does high church the best, the church, and this gets crazy too. If that church has a pipe organ, I'm more inclined to go to it than a church with either an electronic organ or no organ at all.
Okay.
I'm also more likely to choose the church that has the stained glass over a church that doesn't have the stained glass. I'm also most likely going to go to the church that doesn't have their praise band stuff out than not. And I'm not saying this to pick on Living Lord. I'm just saying that preferentially,
yeah,
that's what I enjoy.
So everything you described, I wonder what other people would say.
You know, it's
the I think people... A big factor, I'm not saying the main factor, but I think a big factor is the music. You're describing, you know, a style of music that you like hymnody and things like that, but not everybody likes hymnody. I mean, I like it all. I like it all. I love good hymnody, but I also like the contemporary stuff. I like, you know.
It's not contemporary, but I love a good Holden Evening Prayer Service.
Absolutely.
I think that's a very moving, and that's not high church.
Holden Evening Prayer is 25 years old now.
That blows my mind.
And some people, it's like brand new.
You
introduce it, and they're like, this is
weird.
It is weird.
Yeah.
And I'm like, it's 25 years old.
The first time I encountered
Holden was with Greg Ronning out in California. I'd heard about it. I heard of Holden Village. You know, you hear of things like this, but actually being in a service that was Holden Evening Prayer wasn't until Greg had moved out to Orange County.
Really?
But I think that goes back to it. If the music is done well, I enjoy it.
Yeah. I think, too, the feeling that the music gives you when you sing it. So, like, if I'm singing something and you don't know it, but everybody else is singing it, I'm like, oh, this is awesome.
Yeah.
But if nobody's singing the song or it's too tough, it's got to be that cultural thing where it meets the people and they're able to own the hymn.
Yeah.
Right? Like, somebody, you could write the hymn, but when I sing it, it's my hymn.
Sure.
Right? It's our hymn. We're singing this thing together.
Yeah.
That's the power of it, I think.
Yeah. Or the hymns that strike you at the right time and at the right place.
Like the example you used with the president's funeral with all the world saints.
I think Born in Cry is another one that I didn't hear, or if I did hear, it didn't. And I heard it at a confirmation service, and my dad, who very kind of stoic, I mean, he shows some, but I've never seen, the guy gets choked up, but slow to anger, just a very loving guy.
Yeah.
And my sister's confirmation service, he's getting all choked up about it. And I'm like, dang, I can't sing this song without thinking about how emotional dad was at my sister's confirmation service. And I think another one that does that for me, it'll come back to me. For All the Saints. Oh, I'm the Bread of Life. I heard that once at a church in central Illinois. Holy cow. It was a funeral dirge, just slow and just not good. Then I heard it done again with this kind of Latin pop to it. Oh, it speaks volumes.
Yeah, it depends on how it's done. So
I guess more than high church, what I think for me is the music needs to be done well. The service just needs to be done well. It shouldn't feel, what are we doing? Where are we going? How are we? You can't fumble through service. And I think that for me is at least like service has to be well executed.
It has to be well executed, but there also is a fine line between it into like worshiping God versus a performance. And when we worship God, it's our worship. It's exactly that. It's worshiping God. The preacher's not a performer, you know. It's the word of God, and the Holy Spirit blesses the word however the people hear it, right?
Right. So, Shane's philosophy is, I play on Sunday mornings, but I'm not performing. I'm in worship.
Yeah, it's a worship. So I tell my confirmation kids, or at least I have in the past, like, that's how I learned to sing. I'm not a musician. But gradually over time, as I've worshiped, I've kind of learned to carry a tune, right?
Sure.
And so that's where I just got to the point where it's not a performance anyway. I mean, we always joking, or at least I do, like every hymn was once a new hymn, including Amazing Grace. And people probably couldn't stand Amazing Grace when it came out, whatever.
Sure.
But over time, people get used to it. And they're like, oh, okay, well, this makes sense. So,
yeah.
Just that fine line between turning worship into a performance, which is some of the stuff that you can kind of see on TV. It seems very polished and everything. And then there's stuff like Living Lord Live that is just raw in a good way. Not in like we've turned that word raw into something that I'm not intending the word to be. But you know what I mean? Like,
yeah. Unedited. Not unrehearsed.
Unrehearsed.
Yeah.
Sure.
So there's my sister and brother-in-law go to a church in Wicker Park, suburb of Chicago, neighborhood of Chicago, right?
Yeah, right.
And I was surprised. They have a lot of young families there. They have a lot of justice, social justice-oriented stuff, and they are a church that their bell curve of medium age, if you will, is, I would say, young families and early middle life. And that's a church, very high church.
Sure.
Lots of chanting.
Yeah.
They go through, they chant the preface. They even sometimes bring out the what's the incense thing that
the thurifer?
something, you know what I mean, the one that they swing around and they use incense and they go all about it. And if you walked into that church not knowing that they were Lutheran, you'd have said, this is Catholic church for sure.
Right. Have you been in that building recently?
Been a year.
Oh, okay. When I was in seminary in Chicago in the early 2000s, I went in there, and this is before Wicker Park was gentrified. There were maybe 10 people and three from LSTC.
Wow.
And all I remember about that building was the paint was peeling off in the corners and it was kind of just falling apart.
Yeah.
But it withstood it, you know, like,
yeah.
And the fact was, like, nobody cared. The building is just a shell, right? I mean, I kind of get back to that, too. It's like, you know, my previous church was a 135-year-old building, and it was like, it was showing its age.
Yep.
But it provided, it was like a shell for the people who gathered there in, like, a sanctuary. And so Wicker Park's gone through this transformation. But again, I think you're just talking about what culturally people have gravitated to. So the people around that area are culturally inclined to do a higher church kind of service.
Well, we're getting John the Baptist again this weekend, right?
We're getting John's version of John the Baptist this weekend, which is really different than what we heard last Sunday with Mark.
Kind of that existential.
Just... In the beginning was the light. The light had not come into the world. The world did not know the light. Yes, the very existential John.
John and John were both kind of weird guys.
Yeah, but they're like two different figures. Mark's John is very different than John's John.
Oh, sure.
Or the Johannine John.
Yeah.
To be more precise.
That was a fancy seminary term.
I know. I can't believe I used that because...
Johannine.
I know.
Is that actually how you... Not Johine?
We're not German, so
I don't know. I don't know either.
I'm a parish pastor. What do I know?
Johannian? is that a thing too?
It could be. It can be whatever you want. But my point still stands is like, would you agree that Mark's John the Baptist is not John's John the Baptist?
They did not understand. Like that's all you get, right? I'm trying to quote John because obviously I'm a John scholar. I'm not a scholar of anything, really. But I would say, does that surprise you?
Yeah.
Oh. No, I think for me, the whole front end of the Gospel of John isn't very clear in much of anything. It's very poetic. It's very existential. Kind of this, like, esoteric, you know, hippie...
The hippie
very
gospel.
Hippie.
Very Gnostic.
In the beginning was the word, right?
Yeah.
Ooh. I mean, is there the lineage, right? Who begat this, who begat right. that, and who begat... That's, Mark doesn't have the lineage either.
Mark and Luke are probably my favorites.
Yeah.
More so now Mark. I mean, when I was younger, in my 20s, 30s, it was Luke. I like Luke's message. I like the way Luke did it. I still like Luke, but I like Matthew now. He's kind of come on around me.
Yeah, after this summer, I'm over Matthew.
And I like Mark, too. I like Mark's brevity.
Yeah, Mark just kind of cuts to the chase.
And he just kind of puts it there. So.
To which, I mean, what are your thoughts that Luke and Matthew pull a great deal from and expand on Mark's? That's the basic...
The Q source theory, yeah, sure. 100%.
You're not. I'm not preaching this weekend, right? You are.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Yeah, I'm preaching this weekend.
Good. You got it figured out, or are you going to say the same thing just in like coded language?
That's the hard part about this Sunday. So the second Sunday is about John the Baptist. The third part is about John the Baptist. But it's a very different John the Baptist. So
you got to kind of.
See, last week was more about repent as a way of being ready.
Okay.
This week, it's more about the light is coming into the world.
Sure.
So they're really two different messages.
Repent to get ready, but even if you're ready or not, here it comes.
The light's still coming.
Yeah.
Right.
What a great way to enter 2021.
Yeah.
Ready or not, Here it comes.
Here it comes. So do you think most people are ready for this new year? Do you think most people are excited about when they look into 2021?
That it's not 2020. I think most people are like, oh, geez, 2020 is over.
Who's to say, the thing is, I don't think we should let go of 2020 until we've learned a lesson from it.
I don't think 2020 was a particularly bad year.
I don't think so either. I was thinking about this last night when I was up at 1 a.m. in the morning.
Why?
I was up here all night working on the budget for 2021.
Okay.
So and I just couldn't make that, when you're working, your brain's really working, and then you go home, you try and go to sleep, yeah. and it just doesn't work out. So I was up at 1 o'clock. I'm like, it's been an interesting, but for me personally, I'll use the word privileged in the sense, I had this new opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Things are okay for me.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm blessed in the fact that I realize that not everybody has it like that, So 2020 has not personally been a bad year for me.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it was.
It's been a bizarre year. Back in January 2020, if you would have said I would have been sitting here in Missouri, of course, we never know. But, I mean, I've been like, right.
I said this in the first episode.
I know.
Last week, which was, I got a kid now.
You got a kid now.
If that's the worst 2020 has to offer.
Well, just wait until 2021.
Just wait until he's 21.
I don't.
How do you live in 2020 without Hulu? I don't understand that.
I don't know.
Do you have Netflix?
I do, but I don't watch it. My kids watch it.
You have Netflix? You don't have Hulu. You got Amazon Prime.
I do, but I don't watch it.
Oh, man.
I listen to the music on the Amazon thing.
You listen to music on Amazon Prime? You got Apple Music and Spotify. It's like using Pandora. Nobody uses Pandora anymore.
I do.
Stop it. You don't use Pandora.
I do use Pandora.
Oh, my gosh.
That's why we're talking. We're talking about cultural. I mean,
it's not a cultural thing. It's just like...
Do you listen to the radio in your car?
Yeah. I do listen to the radio on the car. Okay.
I'm talking about FM radio is what I mean by radio.
Oh, nobody listens to AM radio.
Why would
I listen to AM radio? Well, Sirius. I also listen to Sirius.
I listen to, that's irrelevant. But yeah, I've listened to AM radio.
Do you do you use Safari?
On my Apple computer? Yes.
Oh my gosh.